the sad example of our country became a large assembly shop for automotive industry with an annual production capacity of 1 million cars and the highest number of cars produced per capita in the world. It is no secret that foreign automotive investors openly admitted they had been motivated to come to Slovakia by our cheap and qualified labor force rather than low tax rates or significant state assistance. Many are now suddenly surprised that this concentration of single branch of industry and country's total dependence on export lead to serious problems in the time of the global economic crisis. Many are also surprised by the fact that after adopting euro in 2009 and with a natural pressure on higher incomes, Slovakia is unable to compete with some Asian countries in textile or shoe industries. Certainly, after solving such conditions, we can only reap high unemployment and threat for several tens of thousands of other jobs. The global economic crisis made it all even more complicated. Apart from disadvantages related to preference for cheap labor force and concentration in the car industry, we have learned that a small country, we have practically no instruments to fight the crisis. With our economy 85% dependent on export, we have to wait for the recovery in large economies, especially in Germany and France, our main trade partners. As a small country with a small internal market, we do not have many options to strengthen internal demand and boost up economic growth. The only way for countries like Slovakia is big public investments. And that is what we decided to do. We launched highways constructions using PPP projects. We built a nuclear power station, airport, and we have approved many economic incentives on the level of 0.5% GDP. Such policy, ladies and gentlemen, inevitably leads to higher deficit in public finance. The government I chair faces a difficult test. On the one hand, it is expected from us to consolidate public finances and decrease the 2009 deficit of 6.3% down to 5.5% in 2010. On the other hand, people expect from us further commitment to build a welfare state. That is to maintain the social standard which we have managed to improve significantly since 2006. I am pleased to use this opportunity of speaking on the ground of your university to repeat our pledge not to take money from our citizens and their pockets in the name of the crisis. Slovakia has gone through difficult times since 1989, and our citizens showed an immense courage and strength, and it is the first and foremost who can take credit for the economic success in the second half of this decade, when Slovakia showed record economic growth. In 2007, it was 10%. In 2008, it was more than 6%. My government will keep its promise. We will consolidate public finances in 2010, and we will not decrease social standard of our citizens by increasing tax rates, fees, or by cutting social benefits and assistance. In 2010, we will save in government spending, mainly in the resorts of defense and the interior, while slightly increasing the budgets in education, social affairs and healthcare. Prospects for 2010 are neither too optimistic nor completely pessimistic. The European Commission foresees an economic growth of around 1.9% for Slovakia, one of the highest growths in the whole Union. In relation to public debt, it will be second lowest in the Eurozone and sixth lowest in the European Union. We are concerned, of course, about unemployment rate reaching almost 13%. On the other hand, EU unemployment rose by 3.3% compared to 2007, same as in Slovakia. Ladies and gentlemen, with the above-mentioned structure of industry, open type of economy, and exploiting the advantage of the cheap labor force, Slovakia has no chance to be either competitive or get closer to the living standards of the more developed West, which was the foremost dream of November crowds back in 1989. And we are fully aware of this. In this spirit, we shape and adopt all our policies. Our modernization program, with the title Slovakia 21, clearly defines the roles for science, research and innovations. In this era, we want to fully use significant amounts from Eurofunds. The efficient use of Eurofunds became our priority for 2010, also in connection with the fight against the consequences of global crisis. My government is committed to support only such foreign investments which will not deepen our already dangerous dependence on car industry. But we will promote foreign investments which bring jobs to our highly skilled people. We have to recognize also significant regional differences and gaps. The state must invest into better education of its citizens, mainly unemployed people. Real convergence of Slovak economy in the long perspective must be based on creation of new knowledge and its efficient use. This type of economic growth, of course, must be closely linked to social cohesion to bring benefits of such economic growth to majority of our Slovak people. The attitude of the Slovak government does not differ from the fundamental objectives of the European Union, mainly the objective to build, and now I will quote, social market economy with a high competitiveness, full employment and social progress together with a high level of protection and improvement of the quality of the environment. After touching upon the European Union, ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to use this opportunity to thank the government of the United Kingdom for its support to the Slovak integration ambitions during the whole accession processes. Our entry into the Union in 2004 was an immense success, and our membership can be described in no better words but a success story. If we add to this our entry into Schengen era as of January 2008, and introduction of Euro in January 2009, I believe that Slovakia will have some comparative advantages to its neighbors who have not fulfilled the criteria yet or postponed their entry into the Euro era. We even believe that for a country like Slovakia, the introduction of Euro brings more benefits rather then this advantage is linked to the loss of the instruments of internal monetary policy. Ladies and gentlemen, there would be no independent Slovakia without November 17, 1989. Neither our entry into the European Union in 2004, nor our membership in NATO. November 1989 has changed Slovakia's position on the international stage in a fundamental way. From a small country with a limited regional influence, we have become a participant in important discussions and decision-making processes related to principal issues of global character. Quite naturally, we do not want to be passive viewers of those processes. We brought into the European Union and NATO our unique experience.